Well, in this session, we want to continue with our study of basic doctrine number 8, the laying on of hands, something which you see or hear mentioned quite frequently in many churches, that somebody's going to get their hands laid on them. And really what this is, it is a way of showing that somebody is designated to carry on a certain type of ministry. And so in connection with this, we want to see the function of the pastor-teacher in the laying on of hands, and in order to study this, we have to see how it is that it was done in Jesus' time. Before Jesus could designate anybody into the ministry, he had to get tested. And so that brings us to the second temptation of Christ. And so let me show you our outline map as to how we are following this. First of all, under letter B in the unmatched parentheses, we have the second temptation of Christ was designed by Satan, but it was permitted by God. It's important for us to understand that there are those particular temptations which are designed by Satan, and when they are, they're designed to make you flunk. However, God permits these to take place. And so our first subpoint is that the entire temptation scenario was permitted by God, and provision was made to defeat that temptation. Secondly, Satan designed the temptation to derail the plan of God, even if it meant the killing of Jesus. Our first increment under point number 2, the killing of Jesus, we want to see that there are two Greek words that entail the same activity. We call it testing or temptation, but they have different purposes in view. The first of these is the Greek word dokimazo, and I hope that you are embedding these into your mind, because you need to understand that when God tests you, when he sends a test your way, he does this in order to approve you. He wants for you to pass the test, dokimazo. Every time that the Greek New Testament uses this word dokimazo, it means that the person who's being tested is viewed or is presumed to pass the test. It is always that way. The second word is the word peirazo. The D and the Z go together, like that. And so you have dokimazo, and you have now peirazo. This one is a test as well, or a temptation, but it has flunking in view. Now, you may not flunk, but that is the purpose for this type of test. Peirazo is a test that is designed to make you flunk. Principle of doctrine. First of all, 1 Corinthians 10:13, the way of escape, that's the first principle of doctrine, that is that with every peirazo test, with every one of these tests that is designed to make you flunk, that God has engineered, he has hardwired a way of escape. And it doesn't matter what temptation it is that you have. And I know that there are some people who say, but you don't understand, I've got the genetic predilection to do this. I've got the predisposition to commit this particular thing, to yield to this temptation. 1 Corinthians 10:13, God has made a way to escape. And it's very, very important for us to note that. The second principle of doctrine I have entitled the divine inclination. In other words, what is God's inclination? In other words, how is he inclined to act concerning your particular testing? Well, he has a posture, and that is found in James chapter 1, verses 12 through 18. And that is going to be the major part of our study this morning, the divine inclination. So first of all, the way to escape. We've studied this last week. We've seen the promises that are found in 1 Corinthians 10:13. First of all, there's no temptation that has overtaken you but such as is common to man. what is a temptation? A temptation is a solicitation to sin. It is a solicitation to sin. Where I grew up in Chicago, there are various neighborhoods, but there are some neighborhoods that are just littered with striptease joints. And you go there toward the evening, and you don't have bouncers that are out there to make sure that the underage don't go in. No, they got people that are out on the streets who are saying, come on in, come on. If you don't want to buy, or if you don't want to cover the cost, I'll give you this ticket. You won't have to buy a covered drink. You can just come right on in. And it's not just one, it's tons of them every block as you go from block to block. There's somebody who says, come on in. You're going to like these girls. The first drink will be free. And so they are soliciting you to come in and to partake of the activities on the inside. It's a solicitation to sin. How is the solicitation put into action? There are three major ways. First of all, there is the coaxing. The coaxing, that's come on in, come on in. It's an encouragement, you see. Then there is the urging, and that is you have to come on in, because if you don't, you're going to miss something. If you don't, you know, I'll take you out to the alley and I'm going to beat you bloody. And then there's seduction. And seduction is an appeal to your old sin nature. There is something that that person sees inside of you, and he is stroking that. He wants to make sure that he touches that part that you're very sensitive to, and he'll want you to come in. And you'll say, well, I did it of my own free will. Well, you didn't. You were seduced into it. See? And this is very important when it comes to temptation. So I want you to keep these things in mind here as we move forward. All right. The second promise is that God is faithful. God is faithful to you as an individual, and he is faithful as far as the parizo tests. And the parizo test is that he has given you a way to escape, and he's always faithful to do that. God will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. Promise number three. Promise number four, with a temptation will provide a way to escape so that you will be able to endure it. Now, the word endure that is used here in the Greek means that you're sitting in a chair, you got your hands tied behind your back, and somebody is working you over. You're being tortured. And the idea here is that despite the fact that the temptation is torturing you, that you will be able to hang on to your high ground. You'll be able not to break. You'll be able not to fold. You will be able to endure it. All right. Another passage of scripture, be prime for us, be prime, is Romans 13 and verse 14. And there are certain things that are given to us in this verse. The first part is, it says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And I suppose that there are many ways of applying this, but I suppose that probably the best way is to say, I am a Christian. I am a Christian. This does not belong to me. And somebody might say, yeah, but you don't understand. I've got this genetic predisposition. You know what? When you believe that Christ is your personal Savior, a new genetic structure has been given to you. It's a divine genetic structure. That's why it's called being born again. And God has given you His Spirit who lives and abides inside of you, who not only teaches you, that's why you confess your sin before you begin in Bible class, but He is also there to strengthen you in the inner man. He is going to bring back to your remembrance everything that Christ has taught to make you stronger on the inside. And so put on the Lord Jesus Christ means here you are confronted with a temptation. Say, I'm a Christian now. I'm a Christian now. Number two, and make no provision for the flesh, I think is the way that it says in Romans 13:14. And that means don't flirt with your old sin nature. Don't see how far you can go without falling, because you're going to fall. You cannot stimulate the Olsen nature and expect that you're going to win. You can't. It's not going to happen. So I know that there are some of you who are celebrating your sobriety, and that means that you don't go to the bar and you sit with your friends and you say, I'm just going to order ginger ale. I'm just going to pay for the rounds for everybody. I myself am not going to have any. Don't flirt with the old sin nature. Because if you stimulate that animal, it's going to come back and bite you. That is just what this verse says. Romans 13:14. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the old sin nature. In other words, don't flirt with it. Don't give it a little nibble. You know, it's kind of like somebody brings out pecan pie. I'm bringing out pie because I know most of you don't care for it. It's like me, I don't care for it either. I only care for two kinds of pie, hot and cold. That's the only kind I like. So don't bring me any other kind, okay? And there are some people who say, well, I'm not going to have any, but I'm just going to get a little pinch. Just a little pinch. Just a smidge.
Just one
time. I think somebody's heard this. And that is flirting with the old sin nature. You can't do that. You got to cut it off. Well, I'm not strong enough to cut it off. That is why the Lord Jesus Christ has given you the Holy Spirit. Number three, Romans 6:11, and this is making positional truth experimental or experiential. Romans 6:11. Would you open your Bibles, please? Romans 6. And we don't want to dally too long here, though we do want to be able to get the gist. Verse 11 of Romans 6. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. In verse 11, the first thing that you see is the word consider. This word consider is a bookkeeping term. It means that you have put it on your account. Put it on your account. So if somebody says, you know, you are getting paid and it's direct deposit, it is being attributed directly into your account. I know you did the job. Maybe you're a carpenter. Maybe you're a mechanic. Maybe you're a plumber. Maybe you're a teacher, an instructor of some kind. And the person who has hired you says, I made a direct deposit into your account. So you're on your way home and you say, gee, I think I'm going to run out of gas. I better put some gas in it. I don't have any cash with me. But my boss said that he made a direct deposit into my account. Maybe I can use my debit card. See, that's what this word means. Consider. It means count it as true. And so the first one, this word is consider yourselves to be dead to sin. You don't feel dead. You're still tempted. But count it in your account, you are dead to sin. I suppose that this is one of the things that goes through the minds of almost everybody. You go hunting, shoot a deer, shoot an elk, whatever. You dress it out in the field, and then you bring it home. It goes on the hood of your car so everybody can see it. And you bring it home, you hook it up to the rafters in your garage, and you start cutting pieces off. Doesn't that hurt? I mean, you get the sharp knife and you're severing, you're dismembering this animal. Doesn't it hurt it? Poor little animal. Looks like Bambi. Doesn't hurt it because it's dead. See? Same way with you. Sin confronts you, you're dead. It has no call on you. You don't owe it anything. You're dead. You're dead in Christ. See? And that's what verse 11 says. Consider yourselves to be dead to sin, comma, but alive to God. And so let me show you this word consider. Consider is a present middle imperative. Imperative means that this is a command. Present tense means that this is action that goes on continuously. It's linear action, sir. This means that when you're confronted with a temptation, from the moment that you recognize it, you need to be considering yourself to be dead to sin. Not, I think I'll have a little taste first. Then I'll start the consideration. This is linear action, sir. Continuous action. Imperative mood, that's the IMP, that means that this is a command. You are being commanded to do this. It's not a suggestion. You say, well, I need help from my higher power. Well, what do you think this is? Hello? But then it is middle voice, and that's why I have it there in the yellow. It is middle voice, and that means that it is to your advantage to do this. It's to your advantage to consider yourself to be dead to sin. The action is mental, which means that it requires academics. What exactly does that mean? It means that you need to have the doctrine about your death in Christ. You need to know that when Christ died on the cross, he died in your place, and when he died, you died. And you need to be able to take that little knowledge and have it go right through the stream of your consciousness so that you can apply it when it's time to apply it. And say, well, how hard is that? Well, you begin, first of all, by believing that Christ died on the cross for your sins and mine. That's where you begin. And then somewhere along the line, you'll add a little bit, and you'll find that he died for all of your sins, past, present, and future. And then a little bit on down the line, you'll find out that when he died, you died. And when he rose from the grave, you rose from the grave in newness of life. Dead to sin and alive to God. If you're dead to sin, you also need to consider that you are now alive to God. I think most of us who are men, we have been working on cars. And probably, we'll probably not see this anymore, but there used to be pictures of guys on a Sunday afternoon. They go out to dinner at somebody's house, a barbecue or something. And somebody would say, you know, I'm having a little trouble with the timing in my car. Or I'm having a little trouble with the points in my car. So they pop open the hood, and you have three or four people, and you can't see their heads. They're men. All you can see is the backside of their pants. Mm-hmm. And you're leaning over, and they're trying to adjust the points, or they're trying to do something, but they don't have the right tool. And so they get a screwdriver and click, 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 like that. And this is the thing, that you are now alive to God. The right tool is you. You are alive to God. You're not a screwdriver that's just pounding somewhere where you don't need to be pounding. Okay, next passage of scripture, D prime, is found in verses 12, 13, and 14 of our same passage. And so let me read these without too much comment. Verse 12, therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lusts. And I hope that you can kind of take this in and notice the phraseology here. Don't let sin reign, that is, become master in your mortal body. One of the common phrases that you hear in this neo-spirituality is, listen to your body. Your body is going to tell you such and such, and then you do what your body tells you. The Bible says exactly the opposite. You tell your body what to do. Okay, wait a minute, I think you understand this. Everybody I know says, listen to your body. Well, look at this verse once again. Do not let sin reign in your mortal body. It means that you have the authority as to what is going to take place in your body and what isn't. That means that you deny certain activities that your body wants to participate in. You're not going to obey its lusts. Verse 13, and do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead. This means that you show up for work, and that is work at God's office. You say, I'm not working for the old sin nature anymore. I'm not working for what my body wants to do. I'm presenting myself to God. God, what do you want to do with my body today? There are some of us, and I know I've been guilty of it. I woke up many, many a morning and said, well, today I'm going to run 5 miles. But the right attitude is, God, what do you want my body to do? What do you want me to do today for you? And that's the way, that's the right attitude. Verse 14. For sin shall not be master over you. Now notice verse 14, this is not a command like thou shalt not. No, this is an instruction. Sin shall not be master over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. And let me tell you what the beauty of this is. The beauty of this is that as hard as we do not want to sin, and as hard as we propose not to present our bodies to sin, to be instruments of unrighteousness, at times we will sin. And that doesn't mean that we go into a spiral nosedive. Doesn't mean that we go into a hammerhead nosedive. It means that even though we have failed, that we can confess our sin and get back on the horse and keep on riding. Romans chapter 6, verses 12, 13, and 14. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lusts. Okay? And do not go presenting your bodies, your members of your body, to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but instead present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not be master over you. 1 John 1:9. I know that most of you are already familiar with 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. All right, 1 John 1:8-10. Would you turn your Bibles to that passage, please? 1 John. Well, we just looked at verse 9, we just quoted verse 9. We need to look at the two verses that surround it. Verse 8, if we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves. If we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves. You need to be completely knowledgeable of the fact that you can deceive yourselves. First of all, you can be self-impressed, self-convinced. And then when you are self-convinced, you are self-deluded because you have deceived yourself. And so if we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. That is the truth of the Word of God. Jump verse 9 because we've already looked at that. Verse 10, if we say that we have not sinned, so this is an article of sin, an act of sin. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. In other words, you can't pretend that you're not a sinner, because you're going to make Christ a liar. So, check yourself. Because you may be in denial. Have not sinned, do not sin, have no sins, deny. All right, now let's go on to the meatier portion of today's teaching. The divine inclination found in James chapter 12 through 18. Let me begin by reading verse 12. Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, for once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to all those who love him. Verse 13 and 14. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself does not tempt anyone. Now you probably saw the little thing go across the bottom of the screen. The yellow print here is peirazo. This is the trial that is designed to flunk you. So let no one say when he is peirazo, I am being peirazoed by God. For God cannot be peirazo by evil, and he himself does not peirazo anyone. But each one is peirazo when he is carried away and enticed by his own lusts. Okay, we want to kind of simmer our thoughts on verse 14. Each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed by his own lust. Verse 14 is a metaphor. And the metaphor is a picture of somebody who is fishing. There's a nibble at the line, and then he catches the fish. And in this case, it's the person who is the fish. So, there is a hook in the water, and the advice, and everybody already knows it, don't take the bait. Everybody knows you're not supposed to do that. Don't take the bait. Don't take the bait. But you keep stimulating that old sin nature. You keep flirting with that old sin nature. You take a little pinch of that pie, and guess what? You're going to be hauled into the boat. Now, notice these words. Carried away and enticed by. Both of these are what is known as present participles. They're present passive participle. The action of the present participle is contemporaneous with the action of the main verb. Which is the main verb? Tempted. So this means that when you're being tempted, there are two other things that are happening simultaneously at the same time. First of all, you're being hauled into the boat and you're being enticed by the thing, that the hook that is pulling you into the boat. That means that you hardly have a chance. See, you think that the bait is a real edible thing, but it's not. You know that you should not take the bait, but you do. It says that each one is carried away and enticed by his own lust. Well, maybe your lust is money. And that is what pulls you in. Maybe your lust is an underwater mermaid. And say, man, that looks good to me. Maybe it's booze. And what our verse is saying is that it is once you are enticed and carried away, that's when the temptation is taking place. It's all rolled up into one. And it happens so fast that you don't even know it until it's done. Each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed by his own lust. When you are caught, it's painful. And you don't want to be there. So that's verse 14. But we got a few more verses to go. First of all, let's get down the promises so far. Promise number one, the one who endures, the one who is able to pass his test, even though it's designed to flunk you, you will receive the crown of life. Let me point out something. Notice how it says the crown, not a crown. This means that this is a specific crown in eternity. It's a specific category for those who are able to resist, to militate against, to be successful against these tests that are designed to punk you. Lessons. Lesson number one, God does not pay rodzo anyone. He doesn't throw a temptation your way because he wants you to flunk. These passages tell us that. Lesson number two, each individual is peirazo when, remember these are two present passive participles. The action of the present participle is contemporaneous with the action of the main verb. So you are peirazo when he or she is carried away and enticed by his own lust. Is it money? Is it sex? Is it booze? Is it drugs? Is it approbation? What is it? Okay, verse 15. But when lust is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death. On the screen, I've designated the old sin nature with a diamond. It's right here. The old sin nature in the Bible is called the flesh. The flesh, because the old sin nature lives in every cell of the human body. Now, the old sin nature has an area of strength. This is where your goody two shoes come in. Goody two shoes, they operate out of the area of strength of the old sin nature. They think that they're better than you. It also has an area of weakness, and that's down here. And these are those individuals who live high, wide, and handsome. They sin every chance they get, as often as they possibly can. I was in a pharmacology class, and one of the girls that was there said, "My husband is addicted to cocaine, and he's allergic to it." And so our teacher, who's now dead, said, "What do you mean allergic? Oh, every time he takes cocaine, he breaks out in handcuffs." Well, you see, that's the area of weakness. You know you shouldn't. Don't take the bait, but you take it anyway. The old sin nature also has lust and trends. A trend is whether you are going to be an asceticism. In other words, you are going to do things that torture the body because that looks noble and heroic to the rest of the world. And there are people who are forever torturing the body with one thing or another because they are that way. I had an uncle who was like, one of my favorite uncles. And he did not like to go on a hike or any type of anything like that unless he suffered. He had to suffer. And if the hike was over with and he hadn't suffered, he'd roll around on the ground until he'd hurt. Because he had to suffer. He said, "Nah, we had a good time." Well, there are people that are like that. The people that are like that sometimes mix religion with that. And they don't believe that you had a good time unless you've been to church and you walk right up to the front over here and you confess your sin and got so embarrassed, so humiliated, now you had a good time in church. See? That's asceticism. There is also lasciviousness as far as a trend is concerned. And lasciviousness is the bottom part of the old sin. And that is, once again, where you do whatever it is that it takes in order for you to have a good time. You throw caution to the winds, and everything is just hunky-dory with you, no matter what. Well, we're not talking about any of those subjects. We're talking about lusts. And so let's remove these ones so that we're talking about lust, because that's what it says. And then, when lust is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death. So first of all, we have to have the conception in lust. And that means that somehow you have had some kind of, shall we say, an intimate relationship with your lust, and your lust has now gotten hot and bothered. It's gotten where you can begin to have your intimacy with it, and sin is produced out of that pregnancy. And then sin grows up and it turns to death. And that's what this verse is saying. Then when lust is conceived, in other words, once that has been impregnated, once that seed has been fertilized, or that ovum has been fertilized by the male seed, it gives birth to sin. And then sin, when it is accomplished, it grows up to be a teenager, or it grows up to be, you know, the puppy grows up to be a dog, it brings forth death. Okay, verse 15, once again, then when lust has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting shadow. In the exercise of his will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, so that we would be a kind of first fruits among his creatures. All right, let's begin with verse 16, since we left off of verse 15. Notice what it says there. Do not be deceived. Why? Because that's the whole purpose behind bait. It looks good to eat, but there's a hook in it. Don't take the bait. Don't be deceived. And then notice the second part. It says, my beloved brethren. Why? Because even if you're a Christian, you can be deceived. You will be deceived. You're not as smart as you think that you are. You need to establish good spiritual habits so that you can not get hit, blindsided, T-boned, when you're going through the intersections of life. Do not be deceived. How are you not deceived? Well, let's say that I've got a dollar that I rolled up and I put it behind my hand, behind my back like this, and then I bring them out and I say, pick a hand, and I say, well, it's the left hand. Sorry, it's your dollar, I get to keep it. Oh, it must be the other hand. What happened? Somebody must have pulled a fast one on me. Well, that's what bait is. Bait is somebody pulling a fast one on you. If you know that there's a trick, you say, hey, I'm not going to fall for that. I'm not going to fall for that. So don't be deceived. Okay, what knowledge do I have so that I'm not deceived? Verse 17, every good thing that is given, every perfect gift is from above. So if it's too good to be true, see? But if it's a good gift, if it's a gift from God, then you know it's good. If it's in the plan of God, you're married to somebody. That's the plan of God for you. Along comes, I don't know, Fufu LaRue. Boy, I tell you, she's tight. She wiggles in all the right places. Maybe that's for me, you say. If it's not in the plan of God, Fufu LaRue is an inconsequential person in the plan of God. The plan of God for you is with your husband, with your mate. Fufu LaRue is inconsequential, but she's gorgeous. She's beautiful. And what's more, she likes me. important for you to be armed with that kind of knowledge. It comes down from the Father of lights. In other words, you are led in the plan of God, and everything that he gives to you always is according to what is right. If it's wrong, it's not in the plan of God. If it's right, it is in the plan of God. And with whom, that is God, there is no variation or shifting shadow. You can always depend on him. He will never pull a fast one on you. He is always the same. He's consistently the same. He's faithful, consistently, consistently, consistently. He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. An example, verse 18. In the exercise of his will, that is, the will of God who doesn't change, there's no shifting shadow in him at all. An example of that. He brought us forth by the word of truth. So he brought us to our existence in accordance to the word of truth, so that we would be a kind of first fruits among his creatures. Now, verse 18 refers to our spiritual birth. See, we're born according to the spiritual truth. And the spiritual truth is according to the word of truth. And because of that, he has planned that we would be special first fruits among his creatures. So members of the church age are elite. You belong to an elite group, so that in eternity future, you are different. That is something good that he has done for you. Okay, promise number one, you will receive a crown of life. Promise number two, when God the Father sends you a gift, that is by grace, it will be a grace gift. Letter B, it will be a good and perfect gift. And letter C, it will be a gift from God, and he doesn't change. Promise number three, he brought us forth in compliance with truth so that we would be special among his creatures. Lessons. Lesson number one, God does not peirazo anyone. Number two, each individual is peirazo when he or she is carried away and enticed by his own lust. It's not my neighbor's lust. It's not somebody else's lust. It's my own lust. Giving in to lust brings forth death. And there's the dynamic. Lust goes to sin. Sin goes to death. Giving in to lusts. And number four, lust, which is a product of the old sin nature, can deceive you, even if you are a child of God. Okay, let me see if I can introduce one more point here. Process interruptus. I think we're all acquainted with the way that I've tweaked this phrase. Process interruptus. I'm going to give you a couple passages of scripture of how this process interruptus takes place. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 19 through 22. Would you open your Bibles, please? Let me begin to read verse 21. Well, I need to begin to read verse 19. Nevertheless, or verse 19, here it is. Nevertheless, the firm foundation of God stands, having this seal. Quote, the Lord knows those who are his, and everyone who names the name of the Lord is to abstain from wickedness. Okay, notice that there is this particular incumbency here. If you name the name of the Lord, you're to abstain from wickedness. Is it an impossible task? Well, yeah. Verse 20. Now in a large house, there are not only gold and silver vessels, but also vessels of wood and earthenware, and some to honor and some to dishonor. And verse 20 is just basically saying that in the ancient world, they had bowls, let's say. Some were precious, and some were just made out of earth or clay. Some were made out of wood. Some of these bowls were for honor. Fruit bowls, for instance, they would bring a bowl of fruit out to the table so everybody could partake. And some of these bowls they used for urinals at night. They didn't have a bathroom, so that they would have one of these chamber pots, and that's what they would use. Obviously, you're not going to use a real expensive one for that, right? You're going to use one that if you accidentally drop it in the sludge, you're just going to let it go. And this is what this verse is saying, is in the house there's both kinds. Verse 21, therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from these things, he will be a vessel of honor. Now there are many sins in your life. But if you cleanse yourself of these sins, you will become a vessel of honor. Sanctified, useful to the master, prepared for every good work. I think that's pretty self-explanatory. Therefore, verse 22, flee from youthful lusts and pursue righteousness, faith, peace with those who call on the name of the Lord from a pure heart. And so in verse 19 through 22, we have these interesting points that advise us. In verse 22, we have this phrase, now flee from youthful lusts. Okay, we've been talking about lusts. How do you interrupt that cycle about lust goes to sin, sin goes to death? How do you break that cycle? Flee. Don't let them come to you. Flee. What is a youthful lust? That's when your hormones are on fire. You're not thinking. You're not supposed to be thinking. There's an automated system within your being that is taking over. Your body has become the tyrannical dictator telling you what to do. This verse says, flee youthful lust. The word for youthful is the word neoterikos. Neoterikos. This word is not used very often in the Bible because it refers to that very special part of life. You enter into puberty, and from then on, you are involved in that morass. Flee youthful lusts. Notice that there are two verbs. It says flee youthful lusts and pursue. And I'm only going to introduce this at this moment. But they're like two legs of an isosceles triangle. In order for the triangle to work, you have to have equal measured legs. And so there's the fleeing part and there's the pursuing part. And you will notice that that both of these legs on the isosceles triangle have the exact same parsing. So let me point it out here. They are present, active, imperatives. Imperative mood means this is a command for you. This is an order for you. Present tense means that you're supposed to be doing it. The minute that you're confronted with the temptation, start fleeing. Somebody yells, there's fire in the house. Don't say, I think I got to go back. I think that there's my lucky rabbit's foot that I left in there. Or I think it's my dirty laundry. I need to get my dirty laundry out. The house is on fire. Flee. Yes, sir. get out of there. And then there's pursue. Pursue means that there is a reward at the end of the stick. Go get it. It's yours. You see. So with that, we'll leave it for today. We'll pick this up again next Sunday. All right, let's stand and be dismissed.